The brain is made up of many different cells, but the most important of these is the nerve cell. This is because nerve cells are responsible for the processing of information. Neurons have three important components: dendrites, which are processes that conduct signals from sensory receptors or other neurons to the cell body; the cell body, also known as the soma, which is where the nucleus and other organelles required to synthesize the proteins which make up the nerve cell reside; and axons, which are processes that send action potentials away from the cell body to other neurons or to other cells such as muscles or glands. The properties of a neuron are all determined by its membrane. This is because the membrane of a neuron maintains a charge across it. The membrane of a neuron is made up of a bilayer of fat, which insulates and prevents charged ions moving through it freely. But dotted in the membrane are ion channels, which do allow movement of ions. By controlling the opening and closing of specific ion channels, a relative difference in charge can be established across the membrane. The two most important ions in this process are sodium, Na+, and potassium, K+. The cell membrane is dotted with sodium-potassium ATPases, which actively pump three sodium ions out of the cell for two potassium ions in. Also inside the cell are large negative anions, which cannot diffuse across the membrane. Despite sodium being pumped out and potassium being pumped in, some ions diffuse back across the membrane. Eventually, all these factors balance out, so the membrane maintains a stable equilibrium, with the inside of the cell negative relative to the outside. This is known as the resting potential, and is usually about minus 70 millivolts. An important part of a neuron's information processing capacity is its ability to spike. When a nerve cell is stimulated, the stimulus will cause a rise in the charge inside the cell. Inside the cell membrane are voltage-gated sodium channels, and if the membrane potential of a cell reaches a certain value, known as the threshold voltage, suddenly many of these sodium ion channels become open. Sodium then floods down its concentration gradient and its electrochemical gradient into the cell. This leads to the inside of the cell becoming progressively more positively charged. As it becomes more positively charged, more and more voltage-gated sodium channels open, and this process of positive feedback continues until all the voltage-gated sodium channels are open. After reaching a peak, the cell becomes much less negative. This then causes the voltage-gated sodium ion channels to close and potassium channels to open. Sodium can no longer enter the cell and begins to be pumped out by the sodium-potassium ATPase. Potassium channels, now open, allow potassium to flow out freely. This means the positive charge inside the cell then begins to fall again. Some of the potassium channels open during the action potential are slow to close, and this allows potassium to keep flowing out of the cell down its concentration gradient, meaning the cell briefly becomes even more negative than it was whilst resting. During this time, many of the ion channels are inactivated and the neuron cannot fire again. This is known as the refractory period. Eventually, the cell reaches a stable equilibrium again, and the membrane is restored to its resting voltage. When an action potential occurs at a section of membrane, sodium flows in, and the inside of the cell at that point becomes more positive. Some of these positive ions diffuse sideways, and this triggers an action potential at an adjacent section of the membrane. This allows the action potential to propagate along the axon until it reaches an axon terminal. At the end of the axon, the action potential will reach the synapse. Here, there is a brief gap between the axon of one cell and the dendrite of another. This is known as the synaptic cleft. When the action potential reaches the end of a synapse, it triggers the release of chemicals called neurotransmitters. There are also electrical synapses, which we won't talk about now. These chemicals then diffuse across the synaptic cleft and bind to receptors on the postsynaptic neuron. The binding of these receptors modulates these ion channels, opening or closing them, and altering the flow of ions through them. This may excite the next neuron, causing positive ions to flow in, and moving the membrane voltage closer to the threshold voltage, possibly triggering an action potential, or it may inhibit the next neuron, causing the influx of negative ions, such as chloride, moving the membrane voltage further away from its threshold voltage. In conclusion, neurons are the primary information processing cell of the brain, and much of their information processing capacity is due to the alteration of voltage across their membrane. At rest, the inside of the cell is maintained at a slightly negative voltage due to the action of sodium-potassium pumps. But if the voltage inside the cell rises above a threshold value, an action potential is triggered. This propagates along the neuron until it reaches a synapse, where it triggers the release of neurotransmitters, which diffuse across the synaptic cleft and bind to receptors on the postsynaptic neuron, causing the process to repeat.